now listening to the Cowboys from Hell podcast.
Here. We are live.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Cowboy from Hell podcast. I'm your host, Landon Tusiasena. With me over here is my producer and friend, Jason Crane, and our guest today, Teddy Purcell. Thanks. Canadian, former hockey player, and now professional podcaster. You've been on quite a few, is that right?
I have, yeah. I guess I'm kind of funny and people want to hear me talk, so here I am.
So, Teddy, black lives, do they matter? No, I'm just kidding. I promised him I wouldn't get political. So we're definitely not going to start there. The mic?
Yeah, why don't you angle that towards you a little bit, man?
Cool, not a problem. How's that?
Love it. Sounds so good.
I'll sit here a little bit.
Wait, we just need Teddy to sit down.
Should we move in a little bit?
Yeah. Guys, I like this. Once again, we talked last episode that this is a semi-professional podcast. We're making things work.
We're at Teddy's house now here in Hermosa Beach, California. Teddy, a lot of our listeners, so we get on Anchor, it tells us who's listening. Mm-hmm. And it tells us like what countries they're from and stuff like that. Someone in Argentina is listening to us. Two people in Argentina.
Shouts out Argentina.
We also have a really good audience in Texas. We have about 10 to 15 people in Texas listening. But most of them are a bunch of beach trash here in Los Angeles, California.
Any Canadians?
No, that's why you're here. Because we want to burst.
You're the first one.
I figured I was being used for something.
We wanted to break into the Canadian market. So because it's a bunch of beach trash from Hermosa Beach and a little suburb outside of LA, you look around and all the Kings players live in this little town, and you find yourself a retired hockey player living in this town. What is it about this little beach town that brings all these hockey boys here?
Well, we all grew up in Canada, mm-hmm. a lot of us anyways, I shouldn't say all of us. And we came down here out of college or junior. A lot of us that live here now is kind of the first team they played for, even if they played other teams in the league. You get here and you live by the beach. The airport is 15 minutes away. I was always like a middle of the road guy. So people in Canada, some people in Canada know who I was, but the other guy, they're really good players. It doesn't matter if like Brad Pitt walks in the door. People want to talk to those hockey guys.
In Canada. When they're in Canada,
yeah. So they get down here, and there's not much media. The Kings were obviously really good for a long time, and people leave them alone, and they can be themselves. No one judges. They don't have to talk about hockey, and it's a great escape away from the game. Like, hockey gave us everything we have, and we're all very grateful for that. But when it's not time for hockey, you want to be yourself, and everyone can be themselves down here, and little hidden gems. So we should stop talking about it so more people don't move here.
I was wondering how much of it had to do with that because, I mean, I see, you know, some of our friends played in the NBA and we see them walking around town and everyone's like, I mean, even my own family, my dad was like, can you ask Richard for a picture when he's here? But like, again, we don't know shit about hockey. So like, when I introduce you, every now and then, someone would be like,
yeah,
every hockey
now
player?
And then, yeah, one out of what, 30 people? Maybe?
Yeah, but most of the time, it's like, you know, you're a normal guy.
Yeah, it's great. And yeah. I told my parents the same thing. We grew up in Newfoundland, a small town. And when I was a fan of hockey, I still am. But when I started making it and I was playing with all these Hall of Fame players and good players, my parents would come and we'd have drinks with the guys. And they're the same people that my parents used to watch on TV. So I would tell my dad, hey, like, don't...
play it cool.
Yeah, play it cool. Act like you've been here before. Don't be a pigeon. So dad got it. And when my mom drank, she's great. She has no filters. She doesn't care. So she'd go up to him and say, hey, I want a picture with you. And I'm like, Mom, you can't do that. She's like, fuck, it's for my funeral. I want it for my funeral picture. So she gets a picture with everyone for her casket.
Well, how old were you when you... I don't know if the word's fame, but how old were you when you realized, oh, shit, I'm like a deal? In hockey?
Probably not till I was 20 years old. I was told I was too small. I wasn't tough enough. I was too slow, blah, blah, blah. Got cut from a bunch of teams, but I just love playing it. I didn't think myself I could ever make the NHL. I went away to play hockey and try to get a scholarship so my parents didn't have to pay for it. And I always thought I'd have to live back in Canada, which where I'm from, I'm fine with that. But American education looks really good going back to Canada to try to get a job. And my parents would never be able to afford to send me to an American school. And school back home was like $2,000 or $3,000 a year. And it's still a good education. I just would have been set up back home doing whatever I did.
So what happened at 20 for you to say, oh shit,
So I was never drafted to any league. And I was just kept playing. I had played University of Maine. In my first year, I did really well. I was an older freshman, which was funny because I'd go to class and the girls were like, why is this 21-year-old creep in my class? Like, I'm a freshman. And they find out I'm age and they're like, can you buy me beers? I'm like, not anymore. You just made fun of me. But then I started good in the first half of the year. And I remember I got an email from Anaheim Ducks. And we used to play pranks on our buddies and the shitty players in junior. We used to prank call them and say, hey, I'm the coach of this team.
That's so mean.
Show up to practice tomorrow with a suit on, blah, blah, blah.
You're playing. I backed that shit so hard, by the way.
Yeah. So I thought one of the guys were pranking me. So I didn't call the guy back, didn't email him back. Like 2 weeks later, he showed up at one of the games and my coach was like, hey, someone from the Anaheim Ducks wants to talk to you. I'm like, wow. He was like, you didn't email me back. I was like, dude, I thought it was a prank. So then a bunch of teams started calling, and then I was like, wow, I guess these teams want me, so I might as well give it a try.
So you're 20 years old, and you get contacted by a major team. Did you start playing at 20?
21. So 21. I finished that year of college, and then I signed my first contract with the LA Kings.
What was it? There. First contract, how much?
I just missed. So there was a lockout the year before. Mm-hmm. So under like free agents signing or first round picks before you played a first game in hockey was big. You get like $1 million signing bonus.
Wow.
A year, I think. So they had a CBA a lockout, uh-huh. And it dropped back to 100,000, I think. So I got it.
That's still from deal. A little Canadian boy from Newfoundland, well, Canada.
Yeah, it's a $200,000 signing bonus. And I think if you play in the NHL, you make $1 million. And then I played in the minors most of that year, and I can't remember, maybe 70 grand or something. So I made 250, 300 grand. And
okay, so you're going from
I used to go out when I was 20.
No, I mean, you're going from a little island.
Yeah.
You're a fucking bumpkin from a country town. Here's $100,000 plus. You're 20 years old. You probably haven't seen a girl naked yet. No, I don't know about that. But that's what fascinates me.
Do you feel like you've made it at that time, or do you feel like now it's time to go to work?
But once you got that check, what do you think in that moment?
I mean, I was pumped because I used to go out downtown in the bars back home, and my dad would give me $40, and my buddies would all make fun of me because they all had jobs.
Yeah,
and I had my dad's bank card. I'd get $40. I'd go out. I'd have a few beers. I'd buy a few rounds. I'd get like a piece of pizza or a poutine at the end of the night and a taxi home.
That's the most Canadian shit I've ever heard.
And
in
wake
my life.
Up the next day and have like $8 left over. Wow. So I went from that to making a bunch of money.
When
so
you were going out with your friends at that age, did they see you as a potential, like, oh, he's going to be the one that makes it big?
One of my really good buddies was a guy I looked up to, Ryan Clough. He played in the NHL forever and made a ton of money. So he kind of took me under his wing. He's like, hey, you should start working out with us. Then we'd like golf and we'd skate together and blah, blah, blah. So then I think the guys realized at that point that, you know, I had a little potential or had a shot at doing something.
Well, when did you realize, this is going to help me get chicks? Like, did you have a problem getting girls before you signed that contract? Just saying you're a hockey player or coming up in a small town like that. I imagine, one, in Newfoundland, you probably didn't have that many chicks, or maybe there was a lot.
Hey, this is tough time in the world right now. You shouldn't.
I mean, come
on. Shouldn't profile us like
we're
that.
We're still fucking. Oh, I get what you're saying. I thought you were talking about hashtag Me Too.
No, yeah.
Don't objectify women. But what you're talking about is don't stereotype small town people. Is that right?
Yeah, there's a lot of hidden gems back there.
Okay.
How big is Newfoundland?
There's probably 500,000 people. The island itself, it's huge. The town I'm from is 220 to 250-ish with kind of surrounding areas. That's the biggest place.
Okay,
so
then what I was saying was accurate.
That's plenty of people.
Yeah, that's
not people. That many. Okay, well, again, back to the question. Did you find it hard? Because all I can think of because I had friends that did the same thing but in different sports, I just think like, okay, I remember when I was 20, if someone would have handed me that check, the first thing I'd think about is, how am I going to use this to fuck chicks? That's the first thing I would think about.
Well, we didn't really know the difference. Back home, we didn't have a ton of money to travel. All of our travel was for hockey tournaments and stuff. So we just hung out in our little circle. It's almost like the South Bay bubble, but a little bit bigger.
But that moment when you get that check and you realize.
I had a girlfriend at the time.
Oh, I didn't know that.
She ended up dumping me to go to Australia.
Hold on. You signed a contract and then she dumped you?
A little bit after that, yeah.
Oh, shit.
Like, a year after, maybe?
You do give me broken heart guy vibes sometimes.
No, I'm kidding. I wish I had some better stories that but my parents are humble. The place where I'm from is humble. So you're not going to go around now and be like, oh, I'm the man. I just signed. That, you look like a bigger douchebag then. Cool. I mean, I had my douchebag moments for sure.
Oh, for sure. Even now you do all the time.
Yeah, everyone. I mean, everyone does.
Light
them
up.
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
But like, I just think, because again, I said, like I said before, I think about myself if that would have happened, because that's a large amount of money to give a 21-year-old kid. And so we've been friends for a while and I've seen you out and about and like, you know, we get a lot of messages on our Instagram. We have a lot of guys reach out to us and ask us questions about girls and getting chicks. And I always say in the last episode, I said, use what you got,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Like whatever you got, use it. So if that's money or fame or good looks, you know, use that. But I've seen you don't really use that when you talk to girls. You just use your own personality. And so I was just wondering if when you first got that check, you first got that money, were you using it in that way? But it sounds like you weren't.
I'd never use it in that way. I was just always myself. Like, mm-hmm. But then it's different. Then the girls know what they're getting into because eight of us go out for dinner. Everyone's well-dressed, taller in shape, like uh-huh. a little more in shape than I am now. But yeah. But you walk into a nice restaurant or a nice bar, like they come up like, what do you do? Like, you know what's going on.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Don't play dumb. So it's like the other way. Just be cool and don't want
to
talk
to your credit, dude. I met you once before this podcast and I had no idea. And I don't come from a hockey background. I just don't know. I that's why I live here, because it's so far removed from what I do. And you were just so humble and said, you know, hey, what's up, man? Teddy, girlfriend.
I mean,
if anybody thinks we're bullshit, we're not at all, man. Like, yeah. I don't know shit about hockey, which I don't know if you could tell that by the everything about me or just by how I treated you. But yeah. you were just a regular ass dude, and like that goes so far and it's humble beginnings.
Okay. Look, guys, everyone, Teddy's a good guy. Jesus fucking Christ.
No, I was a douchebag for a lot. I was
I'm just kidding. I mean, I do have me and Teddy are friends, and he has not watched a lot of the podcasts. So I don't know if he even knows the things that we cover. I mean, our first episode, we talked about, I had to cover Black Lives Matter and COVID-19. It was very short, and I didn't get into detail, and I just kind of like made funny comments.
I just tested negative yesterday. I'm good. Hopefully you're good.
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah.
Scumbag? Is it scumbag?
I have my mask on.
It's not the scumbag from hell. It's the cowboy.
Oh, sorry.
So my... Our show tends to be, God, someone compared us to Call Her Daddy the other day. And fucking, well, a lot of people have, but that's not what we're doing right now. But I do have questions for you because I have questions that people ask about you. And I know being a pro athlete, there's so many different, like people infer a lot because, well, they just assume a lot because you're a pro athlete. Right.
Yeah. You're entitled, I guess.
Yeah. No, I wouldn't even say you're entitled. I just like, I, a lot of people look at pro athletes and go, oh, that guy probably fucks a lot of chicks.
Yeah.
Right. And a lot of guys message our Instagram and go, hey, what do you think about this? I mean, I have friends that don't even message the Instagram, that just someone texted me today and goes, hey, what do you think I should text back? And he sent me a screenshot of a text with a girl.
Yeah.
So when you're not single now, right? When you were single, I remember me and you, we had a couple drinks. We've gone out a couple times together. You had some fucking great stories, and I'm sure you have a lot of great stories.
I definitely didn't ever write you asking what to write back.
But didn't. Of course not. I'm not talking about you, dude.
Oh, I was like,
no, I'm not talking about you. I'm saying
I make fun of those guys. They're like, hey, what should I write back to this girl?
Yeah, I know.
Lana replies to those guys.
Yeah, so. I reply to those guys. I address it on the podcast.
Stop wasting my time.
But that's what I want to get to. Is like, you are good when it comes to girls. You are good. I've seen you in action. You know, you're dating probably the prettiest beach volleyball player in the professional, which is not saying much because it's beach volleyball. But
I watched all three games. It's like an A-team all the way.
Yeah, we're A-team fans. But when you were single, like, what are a couple things that you can tell some of our guys out there? Because the thing I always try to preach is use what you got. And don't be apologetic about who you are. Just be yourself and use what you have.
For sure. Some guys are more laid back or reserved or shy or insecure. Mm-hmm. I don't think we have that problem because you like to talk.
I'm a talker.
I'm a social guy. Mm-hmm. I like to go out and have drinks. So you're kind of like to be, you're used to being in that social setting.
Yeah.
And that comes back from Newfoundland too. Like my dad is witty and funny. My mom is no filter. She doesn't give a fuck. She's witty.
That's a good point. I never thought about it.
But growing up in Newfoundland, there wasn't a whole lot to do, especially in the wintertime. It's really expensive to get off the island. The weather sucks for most of the time. So people, we call it like kitchen parties. I guess everywhere has kitchen parties, but like a Newfie kitchen party. You have people over, you have drinks, and everyone just like talks and tells
Newfie kitchen party.
Yeah, so that comes from being back home. And even Alex gives me shit all the time. We're at someone's house, and it's like, I'm tired. I want to go to bed. And I'm like, I'm having so much fun just talking and being social. So going back to your question about girls, it's the same thing. Like you go up to talk, like most of the girls, the good looking girls, they're at the bar. They're, you know, they kind of look like they don't want to be talked to. Why are you out in your best outfit then? Right?
So that's a good line.
Yeah.
So, that's a good line.
Yeah. So a lot of guys.
A really good line.
So a lot of guys wouldn't go up to talk to them. Like they're unapproachable. Well, if they're unapproachable, they'd be home and you would never know who they are.
Yeah.
They're out at the hot spots and they want to be seen. They want to be talked to. And they're not going to come talk to you. So you go break the ice. If they don't say anything, all right, have a great night.
So you got to develop your dialogue is what you're saying.
Yeah,
you
but not have like, to. Yeah, for sure. But you
can't not have.
But you can't go up with like a cheesy line either. You just got to go up. Sometimes you can be funny. Or just say, even if it's like you're going to come across as a dickhead, if it's a Friday night, you're at like a nice restaurant or like a little lounge and you know, it's like places where you can, I hated going to clubs. I went when I was drunk because it's like, hey, whatever.
Yeah.
But if you're at a lounge and the music's low, it's a place where you can talk to people. Even if the girl is like a bitch, you just go up and be like, ooh, Friday night, and that's
hey,
like,
it's 2020, all right?
Yeah, okay, sorry.
I'm just kidding.
She looked unapproachable.
Should we use a harsher word?
But even if she looked unapproachable, you know she was, it's Friday, she's been planning her outfit since Thursday.
Yeah.
Getting ready since 4 o'clock, now it's 9. Yeah. She's having a martini with her friend, and you go up and be like, really? That's like your best outfit on a Friday? Like. And then they laugh and like, hey, don't worry, babe. Get them back tomorrow night.
That's good. That's
and
really
then they're
good.
Either like, fuck you, or like, well, you got me. And
this
then,
is this is great dialogue. That's really good.
Is this before signing bonus or after signing bonus?
Yeah, definitely after.
Okay, yeah.
Well, I couldn't afford to go to those nice places before. So, and at a dive bar, you can't say that to anyone. We're all dressed like shit too, so no one cares at a dive bar in Newfoundland.
That's a good point.
So,
yeah,
we didn't have many options.
After. I mean, dive bars in LA, it's the same thing. Mm-hmm. Then you bring up a great point because I always talk about, you know, be appropriate for who you are and use what you got, but there's something to be said about going somewhere where you belong, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If you are, I mean, myself's a great example, you know, if you don't make that much money and dress in suits, maybe don't go try to pick up chicks at the Standard.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Maybe go to your local dive bar, which is what I do. I mean, so I do have friends that they'll put on a nice suit or they'll put on a nice clothes and go to a fancy place and they'll struggle.
Yeah.
And it's probably because of that very thing.
Right. And that's the one thing some of our coaches throughout my years in the league, no matter what, you couldn't wear jeans on the road. So I remember a game in Columbus, played Columbus, we had a couple of days off, so we stayed. And like four of us wanted to go to a movie, like a matinee. It was like 12:45. It was like four of us it was on a Tuesday. Four of us were in the movie theater with suits on. And it was like, man, this sucks.
And you have to do that.
You have to wear suits or you like get in trouble or it's fined, whatever. But also to that point, sometimes after games, I hated going out with my suit on. It's like, hey, look at me. I got a suit on. I got no teeth and I got stitches. Like
humble beginnings.
Guess what I do?
Dude, get the fuck out of here.
Ask all the guys.
It's you like, didn't like that a little bit?
No. The first, like maybe like my first year, but then after it's like, this is embarrassing. Like,
it's not tight, but I can see how like, I can see how you don't want to be that guy.
He thinks
though.
It's cool. We both think it's cool.
I want to do it every now and again, but it's not me, though.
No, yeah. What I'm saying is that it's cool to be out in a suit with no teeth and scars. Like,
but it's
that sounds like you're making every cool chick wet in the room.
But it's
dude.
Cool to go with jeans and a t-shirt and stitches and no teeth, too.
That's a good point.
Also dope.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's like, then you'd stand out even more. Listen, if we all went out for dinner, we stand out no matter what, because it's, like you said, eight of us, I already said that.
Yeah.
So now you go to, even if you went to North End, after a game and you're on the road.
Oh, buddy.
You can't wear your... Imagine eight guys coming there with a suit on. You look like a douchebag.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. You know what? My bad. Yeah. You're right. That's a good point. Yeah. That's a good point.
Yeah, I don't think there's any way to roll into a North End with a suit on and not look like a douchebag.
Yeah. Oh, you're going to get fucking roasted,
like, a team member is the only one who gets a pass, and it's because he has to do it.
Right.
Like, but then, I don't roll in
But the
like
average fan,
yeah,
dude,
mm-hmm. yeah.
doesn't know that we're not allowed to not wear a suit.
No, we would assume that, dude.
I guess.
The average person would assume that. Okay, moving on. Two episodes ago, we were talking about athletes, and we were talking about the two dudes, one chick threesome. Have you participated in a two dude, one chick threesome? Okay. Clearly you have. Okay.
Your silence tells it all.
Now, that being said, so what the actual episode was about was, what I said was, it's funny to me that a lot of male athletes can be homophobic, right? And I said, that's ironic because they're all my friends that are male athletes, especially, I said black male athletes, but a lot of them are the ones that participate in the two dude, one chick threesome, which to me is a little gay. How do you participate in the two dude, one chick threesome and not, like, you're going to catch a glimpse of your boy. You're going to clutch a glimpse of his dick, or you're going to lock eyes with
him. But everyone showers together. You're naked around each other all the time. You come into the game, you take your suit off, you put on your underwear. You're naked. Okay. After the game, you shower. You're naked. It's like...
Okay, well, but still, you're naked, but you're not participating in an activity like that. You get what I'm saying?
I know. It's like, I don't know. It's a tough topic.
It's a tough topic, but because we're going to have another... So we're going to have two more athletes on here before 2020 is over, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I want to get all three athletes' take on this because it's so prevalent among athletes. We're sitting at Malloy's, Hennessy's the other day. And Austin Black Guy and Greg Faulkner are right there. It's me, them, and the crabs.
Mm-hmm.
Every single one of us are athletes. Every single one of them goes, yeah, I've done that. I've done that. It's
like you're younger. You don't know what you're doing. You're drunk and it's the end of the night.
Hey, don't say that. Don't well, say not, that.
Well, you didn't realize how gay it was until later. Yeah. I mean,
he's done it too.
It wasn't like at the same time. It was everyone was in the same room.
It was for sure at the same time.
It wasn't we were playing tummy sticks.
Explain whatever you just said to us right now.
It's because there's a girl in the room in between you guys keeping you from the tummy sticks. Now, I mean, obviously, I'm not innocent. I mean, just recently in Vegas, we don't need to say who I was with. But damn, everyone, that's the problem with this podcast is that everyone knows I'm fucking talking
about. No, they don't. We have four listeners in Texas. Dude.
That's
they don't
true,
know
that's
you at
true.
All.
So actually some of them know I'm talking about too. We're in Vegas and I walk in the room and, you know, my boy is with a girl and I'm hammered. Mm-hmm. And I walk in and go, oh shit, my bad. And they're laughing, I'm laughing. And I go and I make a drink while they're fucking right there. And I'm taking my time. You know, I'm watching. I'm seeing any new moves I could learn. You know, I've definitely, you know, I'm not innocent. None of us are innocent. But the whole thing about athletes doing that, it's just, we have a lot of listeners that are not athletes that didn't play in college, that didn't play professionally. And so they don't realize, but.
You're kind of stereotyping athletes, though.
Oh, I 100% am. But am I wrong?
1,000%.
Yeah. But am I wrong, though? Stereotypes don't mean that it's wrong.
It doesn't, listen, we're all, listen, that's a little extreme, I think, to see it when you're 34 years old. This is like...
You're giving me shit for watching?
No, what I'm saying, I haven't seen that in...
You're dating someone, right?
Yeah, but like 12, 13 years.
Okay.
Back to that signing bonus.
You know what?
Went for it.
This guy is throwing me under the bus right now.
Someone has to, bro.
But Teddy is... in a relationship right now, conservative. He just bought it. He just renovated his house. He's in his mature. You're in your established years, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I've definitely grown up.
Yeah, yeah.
Alex is a big part of that. I'd be dead if
18.
Yeah.
Well, she. So if anyone doesn't know, he's dating one of my best friends, and she. I had to ask her to leave tonight so that we could do this.
Well, I mean, also for anybody who really, really doesn't know, such as a guy like myself, your best friend, who is his girlfriend, is what what we were going to send to the Olympics for volleyball.
Yeah.
With her and April Ross. Yeah. I mean, this is an established couple.
Yeah.
In an established town. And
classy.
I mean, like, yeah, we're out here.
You have such great stories from the road, a couple that I've heard before. And like, to me, I mean, that's what people want to hear. You know what I mean? But if you don't feel comfortable sharing them, you don't feel comfortable sharing them. I'm not going to push you.
Yeah, well, like your mother could listen. My mom could listen too. We can all write a book and...
Okay, now that's the thing. Now, this is, you bring up a great subject with podcasting. My dad listens to every episode.
Yeah.
And he asked me recently, he said, can you not say the word fuck so much? Mm-hmm. He's like, because it's hard to listen to when I hear fuck, fuck, fuck. And I'm like, that's hard to listen for you. It's hard to listen to because my dad's super religious.
Right.
But the fact of the matter is that our parents... We've lived lives.
Sure.
We're men in our 30s.
Our parents have seen way more than us. They grew up in the 70s. Right.
That's why I'm like, why?
We don't know all their stories.
But that's the point of podcast. Not the point of podcast. That's one of the points of podcasting is like, you get to hear these conversations and you get to hear these stories, like things that you would never hear normally.
For sure.
I overshare all the time.
I know, but I think 80% of what we're talking about is still stuff that people don't know. All their guests you get.
True.
You get different behind the scenes or inside scoops, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah,
but
that's
you don't,
true.
Like, what's in it for everyone to tell all their stories? Like, for the four people in Texas that listen to your podcast?
Look, motherfucker.
No, sorry, my bad.
What's in it is like, today, I hate to say this, this is mean, but like, one of our friends has a podcast and it's like, God, it's fucking painful to listen to. It's about volleyball. Are we at 30 right now?
No, we're not. But on that note, we're going to take a quick commercial break and thank our presented by sponsors of Butt Snorkeler. Thank you, Maddie. Thanks, Butt Snorkeler. And watch this little video.
Yeah, there you go. Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Thanks to Butt Snorkeler for... sending us those hot ass videos, and I hope you guys enjoy them. Okay, back to Teddy Landon. I'll shut up.
So we're talking about podcasts, and I was mentioning our friend's podcast. You know, we have friends that do podcasts, and
who, the crab whiskey with the crabs?
Oh no! Hey, shout out to Drinking Whiskey with the Crabs.
Cheers. Shouts out!
Hey, thanks for the whiskey, boys.
Thanks, guys.
I just bought for the new barks. I take you guys down and dice all the time.
That's true. Teddy's won a lot of money from the Crab Brothers. Shout out to the Crab Brothers. That's Trevor and Taylor Crab, beach volleyball players. Now, that being said, a lot of our listenership is not volleyball people. And so it's hilarious to me when I see these podcasts that are like focused on volleyball, or I see like clips on the internet and I'm like, you're shutting off so many people. Like, can you imagine anyone outside of the volleyball world giving a fuck about a podcast about volleyball?
Nope.
Dude, and the same thing with like a clothing company. And so when obviously I can sit here and go, let me tell me about how much you love hockey. Like, who gives a fuck about that? But like, that's why I try to push to ask questions. And I love that we're actually talking about podcasting and talking about sharing stories, because that's really what, when I tune into a podcast, I love listening to comedians. Mm-hmm. And I love hearing stories about like the old times or things that we would never hear about.
Right.
And so that's just what my goal was. But I understand, you know, obviously one of my best friends, your fucking girlfriend, she's got the fucking leash on us right now. So, and that's okay. But within these bounds, there's still so many great stories that we can tell. Fuck. All I can think about is
wrap it up, dog.
All I can think about is the threesome question. But in your single days, I'm sure you saw, you know, what they call, I don't know, what is the term for groupies in hockey?
Puck bunnies?
Puck bunnies.
Can I just say that is so awesome, because I grew up in motocross and we had what's called track snacks.
I was actually just going to ask you.
Track snacks or moto hose.
Yeah. And then
the best company name ever was a company that made dirt bike hoses, and they named them moto hose.
Oh, really?
But we had track snacks. You have snow bunnies. What do you call those? Puck?
Puck bunnies. Yeah.
Puck bunnies.
Dude, you want to know what's sad?
I love it.
You want to know what's sad?
What's volleyball?
There are none.
Yeah. What do they just call them? Surfer chicks?
No, dude, there's nothing. There are no, there's no volleyball groupies. It's And but most of the guys in the Pro Tour are married, if not all, almost all of them are. So there's nothing fun like that. Okay, so you got puck bunnies, and you know, I've seen it in action. I was at North End one night with you and Forbes, and I'm hanging out, and some girl's like, "Oh, do you play hockey too?" And in my mind, I'm like,
"Lie your ass off."
Well, no, in my mind, I'm like, "How dumb is this fucking chick?" Like,
dumb enough.
Who gets this tan in a fucking ice rink? Who gets this tan in an ice rink? So I go, "Yeah, I play hockey." And she's like, "Oh my God, I could totally tell." And I'm like, "Jesus Christ." I end up going home with her. She lived by in the Riviera, and we wake up in the morning, and her roommate comes in, and she's like, "Oh my God, sorry." And her, and she goes, "Oh, it's okay." And she's like, "You know these hockey guys." And I'm like, her roommate is smarter than her, and her roommate goes, "This guy plays hockey?" And she's like, "Yeah." And she's like, "You're the darkest hockey player I've ever
Samoan
seen.
Hockey player." Yeah, dude,
the first Samoan hockey player in the NHL. So cheers. Thank you for you guys hooking me up with that.
Yeah, I don't remember that one.
It was a good time.
Yeah.
Shout out to Derek Forbert, by the way. What team is he at now?
Calgary.
What are they?
The Flames.
The Calgary Flames.
Forbes on fire.
Forbes on fire.
The Flamers?
Dude, Forbes is on fire. When we did Quarantine Confessions, we were talking about Eskimo Brothers. And is it recording?
Oh yeah, we're recording.
Okay, good.
we're definitely live, everybody.
When we did Quarantine Confessions, we talked about Eskimo Brothers, and I didn't realize that dude Forbes did work when he was in the South Bay.
Oh yeah, Forbes.
Oh yeah. Oh man, we're Eskimo Brothers like three or four times over. I was
dope.
I was impressed.
Yeah, Forbes does some work. Sneaky silent assassin.
Oh yeah, definitely silent assassin. But he uses. I don't think he used, but. He's actually like what you were talking about, where girls know. Yeah. They already know.
Yeah, they already know.
Yeah, it's not, I mean.
Well, now it's even, when I was growing up too, like we had Facebook when I was in college. I got rid of that. Like my first couple of years, like 5 or 6 years, how long has Instagram been around?
Instagram's probably since 2012.
Okay.
At least.
So, I would say 13 or 14.
Okay, so.
I'll find out.
Whatever it is. But my first game, it was in 2008. So we didn't have any of that. So it was old school. Like, you couldn't look up a girl on the internet. There was no dating apps. Mm-hmm. So it was old school. You had to go talk to someone or no one's going to talk to you. So now all these young dorks in the league, they see a girl in real life, like, what do I say? I'm like, I know, it's a little different now than, you know.
Wait.
2010 Instagram.
How did my phone get back on? God damn it.
Yeah, my first post on Instagram was 2011. And, I mean, I posted like 40 total photos since then, but yeah, late 2010 is when Instagram came around.
And how old were you in 2010?
25, but I never had Instagram. I had Twitter, but you don't meet people on Twitter.
Yeah, but you're right, but these young guys come into the league now. They're on Raya.
Yeah, I know.
Raya's so fucking easy, are you kidding me?
That's what I mean, but then you see someone in real life without...
Oh, yeah, they're horrible. I've seen them. I don't know. Yeah. I don't even want to name the ones. That I know which ones on the... At least the guys on the Kings, the younger ones.
You go to a bar now and like you meet a chick and you start pulling up your Instagram and it's like...
Oh, yeah, I do that. No, dude, I don't do that.
Do not do that, bro. I don't do like, that don't to show them what you're not like. Show them who you are.
I don't do that to show them, but I definitely ask girls... for their Instagram.
Because it, well, and because well, it, not it's, now. It's, well, not now, obviously not now, but because, oh, because it is like less alarming than ask for your number. Like,
oh, hey, yeah.
Give me your Instagram. Like,
yeah.
But then also you see Teddy's,
but you know what I'm doing.
You see Teddy's Instagram and you see the blue check mark and that's just fucking automatic. Oh my God. What is, you Google Teddy Purcell and you see the fucking former hockey player. I mean, I know friends of ours that were like, that guy's kind of cute. What does he do? And then I said, oh, he used to play hockey.
He's
hot. Hmm. You're hot automatically. It's like, that's like the most, that's, hockey is like the ultimate fucking cheat code.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Like, for sure, I've got to date a lot. Like, I probably wouldn't be.
Oh, no, Alex?
Yeah, if I never. Well, that's just a tough one. But
you two are such a power couple. No, like it makes sense. Like she's boss of what she does, and you are well. You are as well. Like, yeah, it makes sense, dude. Like coming from an outsider, doesn't know you guys.
I would still be in Newfoundland, probably living with my parents until I was 24, and working at probably Subway. Well, I love Subway. No offense, I'm a sandwich artist.
Shouts out Subway.
Or like be a hot air balloon pilot or something. But you can't do that a lot in Newfoundland because it's too windy. And I wouldn't have these opportunities to go out and live in different places and experience different cultures and all that and meet different people. I never would have met Alex if I didn't play hockey.
Well, you know what's funny about that? You know, people say, a lot of people like to judge. We like to judge each other for, oh, you wouldn't date that guy if he didn't do that or if he didn't make that.
Yeah, I remember we argued about that. But not,
how,
no, we didn't
how
argue.
How you get there. That's funny. That's how it works.
Now, but exactly. Now, this is, and this is another thing is that the girl that I'm dating, mm-hmm. you know, right?
Yeah.
I get this a lot. That, my friends will go, not friends, but people that I know. Some of my friends. I mean, I think, oh, would you date her if she wasn't that hot? You know?
Mm-hmm.
No, obviously yeah. not. Like, and there's nothing wrong with that.
No,
though.
Just because I know. Because
well, there's nothing wrong.
But you guys connect. You connect.
Yeah, no, but wrong. Like go back to the first 10 seconds you meet someone. You had to be physically attractive.
You have to, yeah.
Yeah. So everyone's like, you're shallow. No, we're all kind of shallow because why isn't.
You know what this reminds me of?
What?
Cali outfit.
No.
No,
the,
like.
The conversation with Kelsey.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
but,
did,
I'm not, like,
but you a, didn't fucking every, chime in with
a
me.
Bunch
you didn't
of,
chime
no,
in.
But, like, it goes so much further than that. It happens. Everyone can get in this conversation, but it goes back to the start. When you don't know that person, mm-hmm. even if you go to a bar, you meet someone, mm-hmm. like, you lock eyes, like, that person's cute. How many times have you met a good-looking girl at a bar and you're like, this girl's a psycho. I don't want to talk to her. Like, it happens.
Yeah.
Or a good-looking girl talks to you because she came over and talked to you, and she's like, wow, this guy's, like, he's a loser, too. So it goes both ways.
All the time, Teddy.
Yeah. Yeah, so it goes both ways. But then, obviously, you grow to love the person in different ways, and you appreciate their flaws, and they appreciate your flaws and all
that
stuff.
I just don't think there's... I think it's stupid that we even reach out to each other and say, you wouldn't be dating them if...
Yeah, you like, shouldn't even talk about that.
That's stupid. Because,
I totally agree.
Duh. You could say anything after that.
I wouldn't be waking up in Hermosa if I didn't do everything I did to earn my way up to Hermosa. You
right.
know, I mean, same with you and you, you know?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, I don't know where I... If,
but at the
bitch,
start,
you earned your way out here. Don't even lie.
There is one, like that breaks the rule. What's it called? What's that? What do you call that saying again?
There is one...
You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, of course. I mean, obviously, we're recording right now, so it's going
to
be hard to remember, but... Exception.
There's one exception to the rule.
Jesus, that's
it's
the
like,
word we couldn't figure out.
I know.
Dude, oh, that really basic-ass word that everybody learns.
It's like if people, when they become, like, best friends, if someone's mourning or go through a breakup or they're in friend zone forever,
mm-hmm.
and they grow to... Even if, obviously at the start, the girl wasn't attracted to the guy, right?
Yeah.
Because she would have been with him. But then they end up being best friends and now they're together. That's the only exception, I think.
Man, I don't know anyone like that. I hear
but
stories,
there is
I see
stories
movies
like
that.
Like yeah.
that and, but
well,
I don't
maybe
know
it's in the movies,
like
but I like a good happy ending, so I'm gullible. But
you, no, you're definitely a romantic.
Yeah,
like, that's one thing
the,
I know
but
about
for the
you,
start
for sure.
of it, it's hard to say, oh, never seen that guy, but, or even if you're not attracted to a girl, or even if she's not attracted to me, she's not going to come over and be like, I bet you he's nice, or I bet you he's funny. You have to be attracted physically at the start. So then you grow to learn the other or love
but
the other.
But what about when girls know?
You do have to be funny, by the way. Like
always,
it's how I pull it. By the way, producer face reveal.
But what about the girls that thank you have to know? Oh, you're doing it like that.
Yeah,
that's classy.
Well, it's okay. Chime in.
No, fill
that. What about the girls that find out that you did play hockey or do play hockey? What about the girls that find out who you are, what you do before, and then they look at you and go, "Oh, okay."
Yeah, but you can kind of weed them out. Like, I was a middle of the road guy.
Mm-hmm.
I had a great career for me. Like, I was a little muppet back home and never drafted and blah blah blah. And,
cheers.
Cheers. So yeah, you can weed them out. And listen, I can't even imagine what the superstar, like hockey is a great sport, but we're like bottom of the totem pole from basketball,
that
football.
But, and
baseball.
You always say that.
I agree. But still, we still get, so they get that times 10 or 100. We get that way down here.
Okay.
So you can still weed through them. You can see through them like in 2 seconds.
But the problem with what you just said is that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter where you are on the scope of athlete, whether you just signed the biggest contract in the world or whether you played hockey for 5 years and made $10 million. It doesn't matter because the normal person,
dude, it's crazy money.
Either way, it's crazy money.
I get that.
How many times am I Eskimo Brothers over with?
Is it that?
No, definitely not that.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, I mean,
well, why do you have to? You could. You know, that's what I'm talking about.
I was like,
beep.
Yeah, I can delete that.
But like, look, like it doesn't matter because. All it took, whether he was the number one player in the league or whether he's the
for sure. And I'm not trying to compare leagues, but I'm saying
I know. But you just said like they get that times a thousand. It's still
I know, but we get 10 girls like that. They get 1,000 like that.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So,
okay.
Yeah. So
I thought you meant like the quality of girl because like
no.
Think of the hottest chick you see on Instagram, like bitch that works
no,
at McDonald's.
I get that.
You can bleep that out.
But I'm just saying. I'm just saying that you can weed them out in 2 seconds when they come up.
Girls that are like users, like that.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean,
that's... and then you like think about it. Like a lot of people, if you're gonna date a girl, listen. If you have a fling, everyone has flings. Everyone has a past. Yeah, you have fun, but you know you're not gonna be together for a long time, and it's no strings attached.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Go your own ways. Hope you're happy because we're not gonna make each other happy. But the people that you can weed them out so quick, and then the thing with Alex was too. She's like. I've been to one hockey game, and she has her own shit going on too.
Oh yeah, no,
and
yeah.
She was like,
"I've also only been to one hockey game ever." Seriously, one.
I've been to quite a few because of these guys, but
yeah.
Now I'm glad you said that, and I don't think anyone would ever accuse—not accuse, but obviously,
people
Alex
are accusing me. I'm like a—I'm a volleyball fan.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm chasing. Yeah. I'm chasing Olympic gold. And if anyone has a problem making fun of me, I don't care, baby.
Bro, what's up? I love it. Well, I love it, dude.
That,
I love it.
That you know what's so annoying and kind of unfair about that is that, like, obviously you got two, you and Alex are two athletes, right? Two athletes. That is such a huge commonality that's going to, like, create so many familiarities between each other.
Mm-hmm.
But if someone were to say, you know, oh, my friend works at Wells Fargo and he's dating a girl that works at US Bank and they've both been in the banking industry or at least at banks for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
No one would ever, we wouldn't have this conversation. But because you guys are athletes.
Their personality is probably like listen to a dial tone.
I'm not going to stereotype. You know, it's 2020. I'm not going to say that.
I'm just kidding.
But yeah, I know.
You're not wrong.
But there's something about athletes that conversation pops up where people go, oh, that person's only dating that person because they were an athlete, you know? But when it's two athletes like you and Alex, that creates a totally different dynamic. But I think that is unfair to say, to even mention that is super unfair.
Right, people. But when we're younger, you think about that stuff. You're like, oh, what does this person think? Or but when you're older and you're happy, like, who gives a shit what people say?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Right?
Dude, I wouldn't have this podcast if I cared what
people say. Yeah, I wouldn't produce this podcast.
Yeah, but it's cool. But it's going back to, I knew what it took when I was... when I was focused and had to keep playing well because it's a production business. If you don't produce, like, you're out, bud.
Oh, yeah.
They love you until you get traded. And you're like, oh, I thought you loved me. It's like, yeah, someone else.
Coming from the TV world, I get it, dude. Like, you're paid to go do what you're going to do, and it's the moment you don't do that anymore.
Totally.
Dude, I mean, so, like, there's 1,000 people in line.
Yeah, you know? No, but
you're talking about the team, though. The team loves you until.
Yeah, but the general manager who.
But you're not talking about the public. When Muzz got traded, I was. Super sad about that. Yeah. When Derek got traded, I was like, damn, that's fucked
Even
up.
Cliffy, too.
Yeah. Oh, dude. Yeah.
Cliffy, shout out, the only Kings player I've ever beaten pool.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
I feel like Cliffy always wanted to fight me every time I saw him. He's just, every time he got drunk, he's like,
so he, to your point, when I rolled up, so we're playing in pool and I kicked his ass the first game and then I realized he had the best hand eye coordination in the world and the second game he smashed me. Mm-hmm. But I go, what do you do? And he goes, I'm in banking.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right, well,
that's
dude,
funny.
You're the only banker I've ever met who does 2 days with four missing teeth, bro.
Yeah,
that's funny that he answered you in that way. But like, I get that goes back to like why you guys are in the South Bay because we don't give a fuck that you guys play hockey.
Yeah, and everyone can kind of be themselves, and
yeah,
it's really refreshing to meet people outside of hockey because when we're playing, it's you're traveling a lot.
It's your world.
You're in your own world. You don't know what day it is.
Mm-hmm.
You land in a different city at a certain time. You got to sleep. You got to practice. You got to go play.
I think
and then you come back and you can be yourself here. You go down to the beach and you can play volleyball. Jump in the water. You can go to North End and play pool.
I think
no
though that you can
and you can
that.
Play volleyball with the best players in the world too.
You know what I'm saying?
I
love 21st Street.
I think you can say that about a lot of different athletes, not just hockey. In Los Angeles, because we come into contact in Los Angeles, growing up here, you come into contact with all sorts of famous,
totally.
Successful people.
Yeah.
Even successful, well, that doesn't have to do with sports. You just it doesn't get, it's not that, it's not like, whoa, yeah, that much. After a while, it's like, okay, cool. What else? Like, tell me about, like, what else? Yeah. Who are you really?
Right.
Like,
what makes you happy?
Like, yeah.
What
do, like, you do? Or how do you treat other people? Yeah. Like, are you going to actually be a friend to me, or should I just move on to the next person? Right. So I have also, I'm Dan, dude, it's really easy.
Oh, we got a visitor. We got a visitor. It's okay. Who's it going to be?
I kind of like the...
I like it. I mean, I'm not beeping out dog barks.
God damn it. Better.
Better.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's Teddy's dog. His name is Vetter, named after Eddie Vetter. Okay, so let's close. Let's end this. Let's wrap this up.
We're at 55. We got 15 more minutes.
So now I have... I'm going to do Canada versus USA.
Okay.
And you just say Canada or USA. Okay. Who has better this? Okay. Okay, Canada versus USA, ladies and gentlemen. Our guest, Teddy Purcell from Newfoundland, Canada.
Can you say it right? Can you say you screwed up both of them?
Okay, well, how do I say it?
Teddy Purcell. From Newfoundland. Yeah, that's better.
Jesus Christ. Teddy from Canada.
What a host. He does his homework.
I do my homework. So, Teddy, it's been a real pleasure. Thank you so much for having us in your home. It's huge.
Thank you, dude.
Thank you for doing this fucking little podcast that no one really watches. But actually, we respect our viewers. We love all you guys. We're going to end now with our segment called Canada versus USA with a real Canadian. All right. So you just say.
First and last segment of Canada versus USA.
You never know. We might have another Canadian on. Yeah, you just say. Canada or USA?
Okay.
Okay. Girls.
Canada.
Beer.
Canada.
Drugs.
Canada.
Racism.
I'm just going to say all Canada.
Racism.
So what do you mean? Who has worse racism?
Yeah.
USA.
Hey, USA.
We got one.
That's not what we want, but it is what we got. So
thank you so much, Teddy. Thank you guys for watching. Thank you, Jason. Ladies and gentlemen, the Cowboy from Hell podcast, episode 8 with Teddy Purcell.
Purcell.
I said it right.
From Newfoundland.
Yeah, from Newfoundland.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you, guys. All right. Hey, what do you think about that? You guys happy?
Yeah, I'm very happy. Yeah,
Teddy, are you happy?
Yeah.
So if there's
you are so humble.
If there is,
by the way.
God, don't do that. This is a fucking act, dude. He's not an act.
No,
trust me. When he gets hammered, he texts me his bank statements and goes, "You're poor, bitch." He's not that fucking humble,
bro, dude. I'm so glad I don't get those because I'd be so much poorer. All right,
Thank you guys for listening. Oh, Alex, you're right on time, and the whole dog barking was perfect.
All right, we're cut, guys. We're cut.